some parts of the Middle East, this has been a season of destruction and looting and plunder. It strikes me, actually, that we've just had an all-female panel talking about creativity. Now we have an all-male panel talking about destruction. So maybe there are some lessons there. Names like Palmyra and Aleppo have become freighted with a collective sense, I think, of human failure. Palmyra partially destroyed, Aleppo, city of mingling, city of Islamic and Christian and Jewish culture, simply obliterated. And I'm joined to discuss what has happened and what might be done about it by a distinguished panel here, Hermann Parzinger, who is the president of the Prussian Cultural Heritage Foundation, Professor Peter Stone, who holds the UNESCO Chair in Cultural Property at Newcastle University, and Zaki Aslan, who is the regional representative for the International Center for the Study of the Preservation and Restoration of Cultural Property. Hermann, perhaps I could begin with you. Where does the blame lie, in your view, for what has happened? Does it lie with the West for the reckless invasion of Iraq? Does it lie with the weakness of the states concerned? Does it lie with the collapse of the laws of war and the descent of war into a kind of savage free-for-all? What has really been going on in the last 15 years, in your view?
I mean, it's a very difficult question, and it's even more difficult to give answers. Some of the answers you already gave, I think all these aspects you mentioned play a very important role to explain this. And of course, what we see is that things like destruction, let's talk about Bamiyan and other things which haven't happened in the past, and things, this iconoclasm, there are examples even in the period before. Think on Germany, the Nazis, the so-called degenerated art. The National Gallery in Berlin lost 400 marvelous works of classical modernity because it was considered that this is not art. This reminds me a lot of what is happening in the Near East. So there are examples, but what is happening now is really a new dimension. A, in the destruction of cultural property through these so-called ISIS people and really filming it and using it as propaganda. You see how it is exploding and so on, destroying the cultural identity of people, of artificial states after the fall of the Ottoman Empire. And culture was, and I worked many years in these countries, culture was something which gave a common future to these people from a common past. And B is the illegal, excavations, the trafficking of antiquities, which is a problem in the Near East for centuries.
It's huge now, right?
And in all over the world, even in Germany. But now it really reached an industrial scale, and things are leaving the country and sweeping all over the world. And these two problems are really are old problems, but we have them in a new dimension. And the question is really what we can do. What we can do now when there is still fighting. There's a lot of things we can do for especially think what then we can do when there's peace and we can go in and support and help the people in Syria, in Iraq, with dealing their cultural property.
Peter, why has this trafficking reached the degree that it has? And what can be done, in your view, to prevent it, to stop it, to curtail it? These objects are moving across borders. Surely that can be stopped.
One would like to think it could be, why does the traffic happen? Because people in the West traditionally, but now all over the world, are willing to pay vast sums of money to have unique objects in their homes. And until we stop the market, and until we stop rich people buying ancient antiquities, we are going to see looting endemically across the region. And it's an educational process which we need to move in and deal with. A colleague of mine always makes the connection between fur coats. We educated people not to wear fur coats. We surely should be able to educate people not to buy illicit antiquities. And one of the, you say that these things cross borders, they do. Customs are not effective enough in picking that material up. We are not effective enough in giving customs the information to pick up what is moving. And the military have not been, until quite recently, awake enough to realize that actually allowing looting to take place is funding the insurgency and funding the guns and ammunition that is killing their troops. And one of the things that we should try and really get across to collectors is that if they buy illicit antiquities, they are funding the insurgency that is going on across the Middle East at the moment.
This has been going on for a while, though. Has it been dented in any way?
It's beginning to be dented. As you mentioned, the probably catastrophic invasion of Iraq in 2003. I mean, since then, the first invasion of Iraq, there have been real issues around that, and in both of those, the military effectively turned a blind eye to looting. They are now beginning to understand the fact that this is a bad thing for them.
Well, the US Army famously stood by as the Iraq Museum was emptied.
Yeah, I mean, people say that cultural property is going to get damaged in war. It's collateral damage. You know, Pete, get used to it. That's just things that happen. In fact, if you scratch that surface, cultural property gets damaged for at least seven different reasons.
Well, one is not telling troops that this is important and should be safeguarded.
One is not telling troops, yeah. And the organization I do a lot of work with, the Blue Shield, is now working...
Could you tell the audience what the Blue Shield is?
I can try.
Briefly.
The Blue Shield is usually referred to as the cultural equivalent of the Red Cross. I always say there are three minor differences. Firstly, the Red Cross has been around for just over 150 years. Everybody on the planet has either heard of the Red Cross or the Red Crescent. The Blue Shield has been around since the late 1990s, and I won't embarrass people in the audience, but I bet a number of you had never heard of the Blue Shield before. Secondly, as a result of that, the Red Cross has a multi-million pound annual budget. The Blue Shield has no annual budget at all. And finally, the Red Cross on the back of its budget has some 12,000 paid professional staff working on average in 80 countries a year. The Blue Shield has no paid staff at all. We're a network of the willing at the moment. If anybody has the odd million spare, please see me afterwards. But the idea of the Blue Shield is to get those involved in conflict to understand the issues around conflict. So those seven risks that we talk about, the lack of planning. In 2002, the Americans set up six different so-called think tanks to discuss post-Saddam Iraq, and not one of them had...
They certainly worked out well.
They're brilliant things. Not one of them had culture on the agenda, and not one of them obviously had cultural property protection on the agenda. As a result, you had the mass destruction. But just one sort of step further back, when Donald Rumsfeld called the military in to go and plan to invade Iraq, they said, we don't have to do that. We know we have plans to invade, in fact, most countries in the world. But what we need to know, a cheerful thought, what we need to know is what you want as a result. But what we can tell you is that the minimum number of troops we need for any invasion of Iraq is 300,000. In 2003, they invaded with 148,000. And one American general said to me a few years ago now, sir, if you invade with less than half the minimum number of troops, then if you have 10 priorities, the bottom five at least drop off. And he smiled and patted me from a distance above me because he was a big man. And he said, sir, and I'm not even telling you that cultural property protection was in the top 10. And obviously it wasn't. But that mentality is slowly changing within the military. And we are now working relatively closely. Next week, I'm going to the States to talk to the American Air Force about integrating training about cultural property protection in their standard training packages and developing a specific training module with them and with the other three forces in the States. So it's slowly happening.
Zaki, I'd like to bring you in. What can be done, looking at local authorities and local governments, there must be a great deal of awareness of this scourge. How are you working here in the region to try and counter what has happened?
We have, in fact, as ICROM is an intergovernmental organization created by UNESCO, that with similar circumstances after the Second World War, what we have been trying to do is also to support the strategy that UNESCO have, and the Director General is here with us, to support the strategy that has been developed at the UNESCO level. In this particular region, we have been working with governments, and particularly on capacity building of people whose job it is to protect cultural heritage in the countries concerned. So we have addressed the issue through preparedness, through response, first aid, stabilization of cultural heritage. We've developed methodologies as to how, you know, these professionals can work on the ground and can tackle, you know, the issues that they have been facing in the countries concerned. Of course, with all the information required and all the guidance that we have developed also in printed format as well as didactic material that we give them in videos and online, etc.
Are there plans for rebuilding?
Well, there have been actually, now the issue of rebuilding and reconstruction has been really at the top of the agenda, actually, of the organizations concerned. And we have been conducting several activities in this area, because there are basic issues here maybe I should highlight. The issue of reconstruction from a conservation profession point of view has not yet been addressed or defined clearly as it should be. And it is a bit shocking, perhaps, for those who are from outside the field. The conservation theory has developed, you know, many ways as to how you treat buildings, but at the same time, there has not yet been issues, for example, addressing beyond the fabric or the materiality of these buildings or cities or monuments, also the intangible aspects and also the other values that these
and you need peace.
Have.
You need peace first, right? I mean, you're paralyzed by the political impasse, I imagine.
That's right. In fact, at the latest meeting we had at the Louvre, Lens last January, we have tried to provoke also for any peace treaty to be formed, you know, in any of these countries, cultural heritage should be really integrated within this negotiation process, so that also the legal aspects can also be
addressed. And is that happening?
We are trying to provoke to actually promote this kind of work. We've been providing some kind of guidance on all levels, on the reconstruction technical levels, collaborating with another organization, an advisory body to the World Heritage Convention, ECOMOS. So we're working on a steering committee together on that. But also beyond the technicalities, there are also many other issues related to the social, economic, and we could learn. I mean, you see here on the screen some examples from Beirut, for example. I mean, the reconstruction of the central area of Beirut could give us a lot of lessons to learn from as to how we could manage future reconstruction, post-conflict reconstruction in the future.
Hermann, what role can technology and digitalization, what role can that play in all this?
I mean, of course, all these technical possibilities nowadays we have, of course, is of great help. But there are different methodologies. The best thing is, of course, to do a 3D, three-dimensional digitization before things are destructed, of course, but there are other methods to do it, mm-hmm. to reconstruct three-dimensional models even after the deconstructions by photos. There's a method called structure from motion and other things. And I think there are many methods now which we did not have many years before. You can do three-dimensional printings. Mm-hmm. The point is really what and how to reconstruct the methods we have. Mm-hmm. And this has to be carefully thought. I mean, 2 days ago, I talked here about the new museum.
Yeah.
The new museum, it took us 70 years, a ruin on the museum island, and it took us to think about it 70 years. how to reconstruct it, what to do with the ruin. Mm. And now, after so much time, so much thinking, I think the result is really exceptional.
What do you think the criteria should be?
The criteria should be, first of all, a really decent documentation of the state of the ruin. For example, when I listen now to these discussions, well, everything has to be reconstructed. Others say, no, reconstruction, it's not worth doing it. I have first a dream, and then I want to make another point.
Which side are you on? My
dream, I'm in between. It's not so easy.
In between.
It's not black and white, because the thing is, my dream is really, if once we can say ISIS destroyed, this brutal bastard destroyed cultural heritage, and we build it up again, this would be a clear sign not to leave them the last word. This is one thing. This is a dream. Perhaps it can be realized in some points, in some monuments, but it is clear. First of all, we have really to do documentation. We have to go there, the blasted buildings, we have to excavate them like an archaeological excavation. You have to document the position of each stone. And when there is a decent documentation, then you have to think which kind of reconstruction makes sense. Does it not make sense? Or how can you do it? Or you make an anastilosis. But independent from ideology and from dreams and emotions, one really have to look to see what to do. And one thing is very important for me, it's the people. One example, in the First World War, the Belgian city of Ypres was completely destroyed. Mm. There was the front line between British and German troops fighting for more than 4 years. There wasn't one house standing, not one wall. After the war, Winston Churchill said, leave it as a monument for destruction and war, or against, of course. Mm. And the people of Ypres said, no, we want back our city. And this is an important point. We have to ask these people in Syria, in Iraq, we have to advise them, but they have to take the decision.
Yeah, people are more important than Churchill. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you think Germany, having been through what the Germans call Stunde Null, or 0 hour of 1945, the entire country pretty much destroyed, do you think Germans have some special insights into these dilemmas?
We have some special... due to our history, we have some special experiences. We are still working on these experiences, on the consequences in Berlin with reforming the museums. The Pergamon Museum is now under refurbishment, and there are still damages from the war. And I think we have a special attitude, and it is clear. We have in Berlin, like in New York and London and Paris, these universal museums. Mm. And we have a responsibility towards the countries of origin of these collections. Mm. Therefore, we are ready, together with UNESCO, to give any kind of support and help, together with the people in an international action and together with the people of the countries. And this is important. Let me give you one last example. Mahmoud Abdulkarim, the director general of the Antiquity Service of Syria, he gathered almost 50,000 cuneiform tablets in Damascus from all the provincial museums. Mm-hmm. Cuneiform tablets, 50,000. This is an enormous library of the knowledge of man, started in the late 4th millennium BC. And what happens? They are guarded in very bad conditions, and they asked us to train restorators and send package material. So we brought out some of the restorators, we trained them, they went back, we sent packing material, acid-free material, and so on. Because now, and this is what we can do, such kind of actions, is important and necessary that this cultural heritage survives until there's peace and really we can peg out this 50,000.
Should it be taken out of Damascus, maybe? For now?
This is a very complicated issue. These have heaven regulation. There was in December last year, there was in Abu Dhabi, an international meeting. I think it is a possibility, but there are many buts. There's a legal question, who will decide what can be taken out and where, and temporarily, of course. I think all the countries who would take it temporarily were ready to give it back later. But then there's always the question, when you decide to take it out, is it then, from a military point of view, is it still possible? Mm. And perhaps cuneiform tablets, you pack them in a box and you bring boxes out. But with things which are bigger, statues, this is also not only from the law point of view, but also from the logistical point of view, it's a challenge. It has to be thought further on.
Peter, on this question of rebuilding or not, I remember when I was researching my last book, which was a family memoir, I came across the diary of my uncle, Bert Cohen, and he fought his way across Italy during World War II, from the south to the north, and there was a very moving part. He was at Monte Cassino, and he said in the diary, he was in his 20s, images of this destruction should be preserved forever and distributed in every classroom across the world. Every school in the world should see these images as a reminder of what war is and what war does. So is there any case for leaving ruins as they are for their instructive power? I mean, in Berlin right now, you have the Stadtschloss destroyed by the communists in East Germany, once the home of the Prussian kings, and that's being restored, at least on the outside. At the same time, you have the Kaiser Wilhelm Memorial Church, which, of course, the spire left half-destroyed in the form it was in after the bombardment of 1943. So you have two approaches there. Which do you favor?
I think you have to, I mean, as Hermann has been saying, you have to get the context right and the time right. Mm-hmm. So, for example, as Warsaw was, the Poles decided to reconstruct the old center of Warsaw. Mm-hmm. At the same time, the British decided not to reconstruct much of Coventry, and mm-hmm. there were elements of Coventry, in particular the cathedral, left mm-hmm. as war memorials. Mm-hmm. Holyrood Church in Southampton, again, was left as a war memorial, mm-hmm. just in exactly the way that you're saying, as an educational tool. And when I used to work at Southampton University, we used to take local school children to that monument mm-hmm. in exactly the way that you're talking. Mm-hmm. So there are particular reasons and particular times for things. But let's not pretend this is just a sort of an issue around the Middle East. And for example, every small village or many small villages in England have old medieval churches. If you'd gone into those churches before the 17th century, every one of them would have been beautifully painted because the population was illiterate and the priest would have used those paintings to teach. They were all whitewashed over or chipped off in the Reformation. Now you go into an English village church and everybody says how tranquil it is, how beautiful it is with just the calm, quiet, white walls. And that's just a different mechanism of dealing with the issue of destruction. If you go back to Palmyra, everybody has been very worried about the reconstruction or not of the two big temples that have been blown up. Probably the most important part of Palmyra to be damaged was the modern cemetery, where Daesh forced the local male population to destroy their own cemetery. And that's the impact on the local community that has to be addressed long before any international community can make a decision whether or not to reconstruct two big temples.
That's a deliberate attempt to destroy the memory and the past of a people, which
absolutely.
Is a necessary condition for the life and the future of that people.
Absolutely. Mm. But let's not argue. Many people, and you did a few minutes ago, make a distinction between the protection of people and the protection of heritage. Mm-hmm. In many ways, the two things are indivisible, because heritage is the people. Mm-hmm. The people are the heritage. Mm-hmm. And the use that we make of the heritage and the past today is what builds tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And if we don't have that to build and build on, then it becomes very difficult. But you can't ignore what has happened. So you can't ignore the fact that the theatre in Palmyra has been used as a stage, not for plays, but for mass execution. That part of Palmyra's story has to be woven in to the interpretation and the use of Palmyra into the future. At the moment, sitting here in Doha, I have no idea how we're going to do that. But I do know that that is essential to do.
Zaki, I'm going to throw this open in a minute, so if you have any questions, please prepare them. But Zaki, just before we, just quickly, is there a lot of anger in the Arab world about what has happened? We've seen the United States, my country, involved in the region. More recently, we've seen Russian involvement in the destruction of Aleppo. Is there a lot of anger over what's happened, and is there a case maybe for reparations of some kind?
Well, definitely there is anger. People are losing their houses, they are losing roofs on top of their heads, and they're being, you know, homeless somehow in many of these cities, such as Aleppo, and not to mention others like Sana'a at some point, and also in Libya, you have some other examples. In fact, we had a meeting on Aleppo recently, and we had people also coming from the community. Of the people living in Aleppo. That was actually a few weeks ago in Beirut. And one aspect that I think is really fundamental in all this work that we do is that we are talking about living cities. So we are talking about people, as Peter has just mentioned. So in fact, the role of community, and even in the decision-making process, is quite essential. Mm-hmm. There are many lessons we can learn from Beirut, because Beirut was actually an approach that came from kind of outside, although it has internal involvement, but at the same time, it was in isolation with the community who were, you know, part of the living history of Beirut and the owners even of the buildings in central Beirut. So I think the approach of involving the community in the decision-making process is also very important in this respect. So, and again, this is why, I mean, this anger would help, you know, for people to identify what approach they might want to have to reconstruct and recover. In fact, we should use the word recovery perhaps in that sense, because it's recovery of their life and also their cities.
Thank you, Zaki. Your Excellency, I think you had a question.
Yes, this is for everybody, all the panelists, because I think one of the most difficult or challenging elements is always coordination. I mean, you mentioned that you work directly with the head of the antiquities. I know the UNESCO launched an initiative here in Doha in 2014 with regards to an emergency fund. The Blue Shield is doing something, you're doing something. I mean, how much coordination is actually taking place? Because I know in the world of philanthropy, it's always a challenge. Everybody wants to take credit. But really, it's not about taking credit. It's about protecting heritage and people. So is there anything that can be done, or is anything happening? Because I personally don't feel that is the case.
So can we have a coordinated response from the panel, please? Work it out between you, okay?
May I start? Because in fact, this is actually at the heart of the work that we have developed as kind of, you know, when we had this meeting lately at the Louvre and even at UNESCO, we had a meeting on Iraq. Lately, we had a meeting on Aleppo. In fact, the coordination has become really on the surface. So in fact, there are now coordination committees and international committees for the various countries concerned. Usually, this is under the auspices. This is usually under the auspices of UNESCO, where we are all involved. So, So, in fact, I mean, when I talked about ICRAM as a technical body created by UNESCO, we're not really working in isolation of. But however, having said that, in fact, coordination should be more efficient and better improved, I mean, in that sense. Hello.
It was in the beginning of June of last year that UNESCO and the German Foreign Office organized a conference, a Syria conference in Berlin. There have been from 30 countries, more than 150 people from Australia to Canada, from different groups acting in Syria, really to design a roadmap how to go on. And it showed also how difficult it was, because different Syrian groups did not want to speak to each other and so on and so on. The one came in, the others went out, and very complicated. But I think in this, UNESCO is the right organization, but UNESCO needs our all support. And I want to remind that your country is not anymore member of UNESCO, which is an important issue to address it. It needs, UNESCO is the organization we founded to organize such things, but they need our all support.
Thank you, Bob. Just to follow up on Excellency Sheikha Mayasa's remarks, you touched a very sensitive issue, madam. Indeed, coming back to the Syria peace negotiations in Geneva, the international community is trying to also to deal with this very important subject of saving the heritage of Syria. However, I think it is very important that we have to link up your specialized process as UNESCO with the political process at the United Nations, where we also have the international support group of which many countries, also Qatar, is a member. And I think this is a kind of important message you should give from this conference to the team of Stefan de Mistura, the United Nations Special Envoy for Syria, and the ISSG to also deal with it. I think, as you just said about the US general, it may not be the most important or not among the first 10 items on that very important list, but it is also a kind of confidence-building measure to bring those warring parties together, still trying to sit around the table. Thank you.
I mean, that's an absolutely crucial point, because that wasn't a military decision taken to halve the number of people to invade. It was a political decision. And until we get the politicians thinking about the value of culture and the value of cultural heritage to communities, then this whole initiative is going to fail. And when we fail, it becomes incredibly difficult for the community post-conflict to succeed on all sorts of different levels. And I could go on for that for hours, but...
And I would like to add, just to take it further, a little bit on coordination, as Her Excellency mentioned. But coordination also, we talked about even local coordination. I mean, also, again, I go back to Beirut, because what we call integrated conservation with the different sectors are very important. But also with the donors. Donors, in fact, usually the money comes all of a sudden, you know, being ready for reconstruction projects, and we have little capacities on the ground, and we are not really ready. And once we become ready, you know, the financial resources start to diminish little by little. So I think what we have also tried to develop also is guidance even for those countries who would be giving some donations to the reconstruction process.
Yes, sir.
I would like to add a point which I think is crucial as well. So I'm a strong enemy of looting, and I'm a strong enemy of the illegal trade. Having said that, I do have a commercial activity and I do have a scientific activity. I was at the Abu Dhabi conference, and I probably was the only person there with a commercial activity. So I agree also to the fact illegal trade is criminal. But what about legal trade? And what about coordinating all your efforts with legal trade?
All right. I'll put my
it's head, over to you guys.
I'll put my head into my mouth. To me, there is frequently a very, very narrow and blurred and grey distinction between illegal and legal. There are a colleague of mine went into, I think, six different sales rooms in London with a box of antiquities. And can you sell these for me? All of them were illicit. Of the 10 objects in the box, they said, yes, we can sell these 8 without any problem at all. These 2 we can't sell because you see this inscription. It says it's the catalogue number from the Iraq National Museum. Okay, 2 of those 6 legal outlets said, however, if you do this and get rid of this in this way, then we'll sell them for you.
In
Mike, do you have a mic?
But I think exactly as you that what you're saying is absolutely horrifying. Now, having said that, coordinating our efforts with the legal trade is even more important.
Yeah, I agree.
Hermann?
Yes, and for example, we have now a new law in German, and it's saying you can trade legally whatever you want if the objects to be traded have an object ID with an export license from the countries of origin. This, of course, until now, very few cases, but this is the way for the future. Maybe the result will be there are not anymore so many pieces on the market, but this is the only way to do it legally. And another point of view is, and there we need really the cooperation with you, we started perhaps a year ago a project which is called Illicit, and to this dark field, to do research on this dark field, on these mechanisms on the illegal trafficking of antiquities. And we are doing this with other museums, with police departments, with many different institutions, ministries, because if you know the modus operandi of these gray, dark, illegal structures, you really can more efficiently act against it. And this is important also for the commercial sector, because you do not want to be partner of such people. You want to have a legal antiquity trade, which is completely fine. But I think we all have to work together to understand it better and to fight it more efficiently.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. I thank you all.